Alrighty. Well, good evening, good evening. It's time to get started. Glad you're here, and I know you're as excited as I am to hear Mr. Hodges again. So I'll open us with a word of prayer, and then we will turn it over to him so he can make use of the full time. So let's begin with prayer, and then we'll welcome Mr. Hodges. Our Father, we thank you for this evening, and thank you for the good week we've had so far. Thank you for your kindness to us. Thank you for the work of John and David and these talks thus far. Thank you for the opportunity to sing and to pursue greater skill and joy in the area of music. And we ask that you would bless our time, strengthen us, encourage us, help us to be spurred on to even greater faithfulness in music and in serving you in this life. Bless John, give him clarity of mind as he encourages us, and may we be receptive to what he has to say. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Welcome, Mr. John Hodges.
Well, you're very brave. You came back for a second session. Coraggio tutti. I've got a funny story about that. Do you know the, if you know the Mahler 8th Symphony, do you know this symphony? It's called, the nickname, the Symphony of 1,000. It doesn't actually have 1,000 people, but it does call for nearly 500 people in the performance. It's called for a full symphony orchestra, about 110 players, and about two separate choirs, and each one usually has, 125, 150 people in it. It's massive. Every percussion instrument you can think of, it is this huge ordeal. And the story goes that this Italian orchestra was performing this with, getting all ready. And the conductor came out. They announced him, and he came out, and he walked up to the podium. And you heard the orchestra, And as he was getting up on the podium, he was just shaking with excitement, And he was ready to give this great big E-flat major chord to the organ. It calls for an organ, too, pipe organ. And the whole chorus goes, Veni, Veni Creator Spiritus, calling on the Holy Spirit to come. It's a massive moment, okay? And as he was getting up there, he was just shaking with excitement, and he was just about to give the downbeat, and the first violinist thought he was afraid, thought he was fear, full of fear, and he said, Coraggio, maestro. And then broke everything. What? Shut up. But that was his coraggio, coraggio tutti. Anyway, right. Well, tonight I would like to speak about beauty and talk to you about how it is that beauty is understood, I think, maybe my opinion about how beauty might be understood best from a Christian perspective. Any philosopher worth his salt has to account for three key ideas: truth, goodness, and beauty. Those three. They have to have some kind of an answer for those. How do we know what's true? How do we know what's good? And how do we know what's beautiful? Now, we Christians understand very clearly that the first two are pretty easily understood by way of the scriptures. We look to the scriptures to tell us what's true, right? Well, we're told that Jesus himself is actually what the truth is, right? We get it in his word, in his revealed word, but it's the person of Christ himself that is called true. So when he says, I am the truth, it still should make our hair on our arms stand up. It's an amazing statement. People, no other philosopher, no other religious leader would ever dare to call himself the truth. I'm not going to teach you the truth. The Buddha would teach you the truth, right? Lead you into enlightenment. Or Muhammad, is the prophet of Allah. And he said, he would say, I can teach you what Allah has revealed to me. But he never would have said, I am the truth. Only Jesus said that. So it's a striking thing. So we get it from the scriptures, and we get it from the person of Christ. Well, how do we know what's good? We get it from the scriptures, don't we? We're told what's good, what the law is. We're told what it looks like to be full of the Spirit. We know what good looks like, ethically speaking, from the scriptures. It's very clear. What about beauty? Does the scripture actually teach us about beauty? That's a little harder, isn't it? A lot of my Christian brothers and sisters are very quick to say, truth is objective, truth is a person, truth is a specific thing, and you can be in line with it or not. Goodness is the same way. But when you get to beauty, beauty is in the eye of the beholder. Beauty is a matter of personal preference. Beauty is just whatever is pretty to you. Well, I want to argue that the scripture, I think, teaches that God himself is what beauty is too, just like the other two. Just like the other two. So how do we get that, though, out of the scriptures? How do we understand that? Well, first of all, I'd go to Psalm 27. And you all will know Psalm 27, verse 4 says, one thing, this is David, one thing I ask of the Lord, one thing I desire, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. And many people stop right there. That's a great thing to want. I want to dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. But that's not where it stops, is it? What does it say from there? Do you remember? One thing I desire, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to do a certain thing. Do you know what it is? That's it. To behold the beauty of the Lord. To gaze, some translations say, upon the Lord. To gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. Now, that says to me that whatever I don't know about beauty, at least I know that my desire for beauty in my life is only going to be finally satisfied when I see him. So he is somehow the satisfaction for that longing I have for the beautiful. So, if that's the case, I think it's fair to say that God can draw us to him by way of beauty. Now, don't want to eliminate truth and goodness. Those are important too, right? We don't want to drop those. But we certainly don't want to think of beauty as only a personal experience and not connected to something transcendent. And I think that tells us at least that God himself is beautiful. So, maybe, and this is my theory now, maybe when we see things in this life that are beautiful, or hear things in terms of music, see paintings, or see the Rocky Mountains, or the Grand Canyon, or see our beloved spouse, or child, or anything that we find beautiful in this world, maybe God is drawing us to him through that thing. Maybe what we're supposed to be able to do is not just see that thing, but in a sense, see God through that thing. Do you see what I mean? I may have said this last year, but I'll say it again. There was a story that C.S. Lewis told somewhere, and I've yet to figure out where it is. I read it long ago, and I haven't found it in a long time. But it's in his writing somewhere, where he says, a man is in the garden tending his roses. And he's so overwhelmed by the beauty of these roses that he stops his pruning and his weeding and all that and stops and prays and thanks God for the beauty of the roses. These are glorious, Lord. Thank you for these roses. And God speaks back to him and says, you're welcome. And then he says, but just imagine what it's going to be like for you to see an unfallen rose. Because the fall has affected everything, you see. And those roses are no longer what they would be, what they could be, what they will be one day. And of course, now he's astonished. But God astonishes him one more time and says, and just imagine what it will be like to see an unfallen rose through unfallen eyes. Because your eyes have been damaged by the fall too. And they are dull and unable. You see? And I think that's what Lewis is trying to say is we need to be able to see not the rose itself, but through the rose to the God that made it. And maybe we can apply that same kind of thinking to all that we see is beautiful. And if that's the case, it eliminates one of the biggest problems with beauty. Because beauty, like any other good thing, can become an idol for us. Many people have become, I think, what would you say, idolaters, I guess, about beauty. They latch on to something that they really love and appreciate and see beauty in, and latch on to that and hold on to that, either music that they love or paintings that they love or places that they always want to go, you know, or something in this life. And, you know, you can make an idol of nearly anything. And the greater the thing is, the closer it is maybe to being like God, the more temptation it is to make that into an idol. So to see through something to God instead of making it the thing that you want eliminates that possibility. That's a very good thing spiritually. So how is it then that the scriptures speak of beauty? They speak directly, I think, in places like Psalm 27, but they also speak in other ways, and that's those other ways that I want to try and discuss today, and then show you some bits of music that I think exemplify some of the kind of relationship that you find in the beauty of the scriptures here. Let me show you what I mean. In Mark 4, Jesus is teaching his disciples, his followers there, and he tells them a story. You know the story. He tells them a parable. He says, a sower went to sow some seed, and some seed fell here, and some seed there, and there, and there, and the birds came and ate this, and you know the story. The good soil bears fruit to 60, 100 fold. I'm just shortening the parable. You all know the parable of the sower. And then he does something very strange. Have you noticed? He says, bye. He just walks away. He doesn't explain anything. You read it in the next few lines, it says the disciples came to him later on and said, huh? What? And he kind of chides them. He quotes Isaiah 6 first and says, I speak in parables because, and he tells them about how the parables are to keep those whose hearts are hard from hearing the truth, which is a whole sermon all by itself that we could talk about. But the next bit he says is, if you don't understand how to interpret the parables, how are you going to understand any of this, any of the parables, how are you going to understand the kingdom, basically? So in a sense, he chides them. Just gently, he tells them, you should have been able to do this. And then he unpacks it for him, and he says, the seed is the word of God, and some of it fell here, and Satan came and ate it, took it away, and so on. It tells the whole story. But the point I want to make is, we Christians are the ones that should be able to understand the parables. You see? We're not the ones that have blinded hearts. We're not the ones who have deaf ears. We're the ones who have committed ourselves to him. We are the ones of faith. We should know better. We should know how to do that. Well, what is it exactly that he's asking us to do? I think he's asking us to exercise two big things. First, patience. Because it takes something to be able to unpack, takes some time to unpack a parable like that. And the second thing is an imagination. I think that your imagination is a gift from God specifically geared so that you might understand poetically, metaphorically, what it is God is saying. I mentioned this metaphorical aspect last night. I'll bring it up again now. We are finite, and even though we are spiritual, we are material. You know that reality is in two parts, right? There's a physical aspect to it. There's a spiritual aspect to it. Not that they're separated. I'm just separating them for this discussion. But there's a material reality around you that you can see and taste and smell.
But there's a spiritual reality that is invisible and yet just as real. In fact, you could make the argument that it's more real. Because the material world actually depends for its existence on the immaterial, doesn't it? It's the invisible God who sustains the material world that we live in. So we'd be foolish to think that the world is only one or the other, to think of the world as only material or only spiritual. And yet those are the two options that we're given today in the modern world. We're told if you're a Westerner, you're told that the whole spiritual aspect of it is really not very important or non-existent altogether. The physical world is what matters. There's a little joke there. Did you hear that? I didn't think of it that way, but that's what it is. Our language kind of betrays the fact that we are materialists. We say if something is significant or if it has import, then it matters. Isn't that interesting? In our law courts, if we want to say that evidence that you're bringing in doesn't apply to this case, we call it immaterial. Isn't that interesting? So we kind of assume that the material is real and the immaterial, as it were, is at least less than real, more subjective, more interpretive, more relative. But the Eastern world makes the opposite mistake. The Eastern world says, you know this material world you're talking about? Yeah, it doesn't really exist. The only thing that really does exist is the invisible world, you see. It's an illusion. The Hindus would tell you that it's Maya. Maya, it's an illusion. The difference between the carpet and the pew and the person sitting in the pew is an illusion. It's all one. It's all one. So they make the mistake of ignoring or rejecting the physical world and embracing some kind of spiritual reality, and all of their work is to get in touch with, kind of become enlightened about the reality that everything is one. This is Hinduism in particular. And both of them are mistaken. Sorry. And you know how we know that? The incarnation. The reality of the two are fused together in one person. He stands in our place and saves our souls. But the reality that he speaks of is that there is both material and immaterial together. It's all there together. So, I say all that in order to say that for a God like that to reveal himself to us in this material world, he knows that he's got to reveal himself in a way that we can relate to, that we can understand, that will speak to us. And how is that? By metaphors. The purpose of a metaphor is to take and shape material into the shape of the thing that you can't see, so that the thing you know opens your eyes to the thing you don't know. Do you see? On a non-scriptural basis, I usually use the metaphor from Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet, where Romeo sees Juliet in the balcony and he says, "What light through yonder window breaks? It's amazing to me. Look at all that light. It is the east and Juliet is the sun." Well, he's seeing her at night, by the way. But never mind. That's how radiant she is, right? She's so beautiful to him that she shines like the sun. So he says, Juliet is the sun. Well, we know Juliet isn't the sun, right? But that's how metaphors work. Well, where does Shakespeare get that idea? Gets it from the scriptures. How does God reveal himself to us? He says, I'm a king. Well, we know about kings. He says, I'm a shepherd. Well, we know about shepherds, right? He says, I'm the vine and you are the branches. Well, we can look at vines and branches. We can see those things, you see. And that's how he opens our eyes to things that we can't see. Well, that's genius, right? That's genius. And now you see why it's so important for you to be able to unpack parables. You have to be able to unpack metaphors. You have to be able to hear him say, a sower went to sow some seed and shows you this story. And then you get, I see something of the kingdom work there. I see how the word goes forth and I see the problems that the word encounters in this broken world. And I see the goal that he's got for it. And of course, the soil itself, each of those soils, is you. But you need an imagination, and you need patience to be able to unpack that, to be able to see it. Do you see that? Well, I want to say this too, and I'm not going to go too far down this road. I hope have a whole series of lectures on this idea. But I think I'll just give you to you an example from my own experience. I was reading many years ago. I was reading through these metaphors that Jesus uses about himself. I'm the vine. I'm the door. I am the way. I am the truth. I'm the not the truth so much, but I am the bread. I'm in John 6. On and on and on. He has all these I am this and I am that relationships, metaphoric descriptions of himself. And I was thinking to myself, kind of meditating on it and thinking, how would the disciples hear this? Well, they probably heard, you know, vines and branches, right? And they all went, well, yeah, we know vine and branches. And he says, well, I'm like the vine and you're like the branch. See, we fit together like that. Ah, dink, the little light goes on, you see. And they get the idea. But as I was thinking that, it was like my whole world turned upside down. Because the vine and the branch that he's referring to didn't accidentally occur. You see? The guy who was speaking to them was the one who created vines and branches. In other words, it wasn't that he was saying, you know, vines and branches, they're a kind of reality. Yeah, well, I'm kind of like that. Our relationship is kind of like that. Just the opposite. He was saying, you know me, right? I'm the creator of the universe, and the only life you can find is in me. And I made vines and branches to look like me. Maybe if it weren't for the fact that he's the vine and we're the branches, we wouldn't have vines and branches. It would be something else. Do you see? Well, it kind of blew my mind. And suddenly everything, the whole universe suddenly became a really complicated and very expensive sermon illustration. But then it dawns on me, maybe this is the purpose of art. You see? Maybe art is for the purpose of opening our eyes by metaphoric relationship to those invisible things that we can't know otherwise. Now, I'm not saying that we artists are suddenly writing scripture when we make art. Don't get me wrong. I'm just saying that in an imitation of our creator, we craft metaphors. And it's possible not just that we can understand God better that way, but maybe we can understand everything better that way. People who know how to craft a sermon and give a good illustration of their point often use story, poetry, right? Reference to painting, reference to music. Why? Because those things are crafted to be able to speak to this invisible reality. They are ways of embodying the thing that you're trying to talk about. Does that make sense? Well, think about that a little with me as I talk to you about a few examples. I love stories. I love stories for this very reason, because they are ways to open your eyes to various aspects of reality. The metaphor, I'll just go back to the Juliet is the sun for a second. The Juliet is the sun metaphor is a way for you not only to see Juliet, but better than that, it's to see Juliet through Romeo's eyes. Do you see? You get to get inside his head, in his heart. You get to relate to him as a human being. In a way, you don't necessarily see Juliet. You only see what he sees. So when he says Juliet is the sun, you can, in a sense, participate in that experience vicariously of being smitten. You all have been smitten before, I suppose. I can tell you a quick story. I was teaching this Juliet is the sun metaphor to a Sunday school class one time, and I said, you can take apart a metaphor, you can unpack it, but it always gets very complicated and ungainly. Like, for example, you could say, instead of saying Juliet is the sun, you could say light and heat radiate from Juliet's face in much the same way that light and heat radiate from the sun. You could say that. All that's at least in there, right? And then I said, and ladies, which would you rather have anyway? And I heard one lady in the front row elbow her husband, and she said, I'd take it either way. Anyway, so that's what that is. So maybe art has the ability to open our eyes to things that we couldn't see otherwise. Now, if that's the case, imagine for a minute that we live in a culture that assumes that art is only for the purposes of individual entertainment, momentary diversion, you see, and purely sort of it, purely relativistic to me. You're not any more able to get, you're not thinking of getting to any kind of truth by it. You're only thinking, does it entertain me? Does it make me happy? Does it please me at this moment? Look how truncated then our lives are, if that's the case. Because if art is intending to open your eyes to things that you've never seen before, and you assume art is for the purposes of entertaining me, how much energy are you going to put into looking at that painting or listening to that music or any of that, you see? It's not going to be something that you will put energy and time into because the purpose of it was just to entertain me. If it didn't catch me in the first 10 seconds of the song, I'm just turning the channel. I'm changing the, you know, moving on to the next thing. Because we think, what else is there? All it is whether it entertains me, you see? But I don't think that's what it was for. Maybe I have a minute to tell you this story. I haven't thought about putting this in here, but I might. Do you know, we were talking about music a lot during the day at this Psalm Tap symposium that Jared put together. Wonderful time, Jared. Thank you again for that. And all the guys that spoke, just wonderful. Do you know where the word music comes from? Do you know the nine muses, the Greek muses? Yeah? Can anybody name the nine muses? Some of you classical students? No, can't do it. Right. Well, there are nine of them. I won't bother with them all now, but they are nine of them. And they are the sons, or the daughters, rather, of Zeus, the great Greek god, top of the gods, Zeus, right? So they're very powerful, but not with Hera. You know, Zeus had a lot of children with other women, other goddesses. And he had these nine daughters with another woman called, and her name is Mnemosyne. Have you ever run into that name? Mnemosyne. And Mnemosyne means memory. Isn't that interesting? Well, the nine muses are the ones that inspire epic poetry, lyric poetry, drama, that is comedy and tragedy, music, as we call it, what we would call mythology, what they call theology, but the crafting of stories about the gods, astronomy, and dance. Terpsichore is the muse of dance. And so they would say that Cleo is the goddess, the muse of history, and she's the one who inspired Thucydides to write the Peloponnesian War. Calliope is the muse that's of epic poetry, and so she inspired Homer to write the Iliad and the Odyssey, and so on and so on. Sophocles to write Oedipus the King, and so on. So the great accomplishments, the greatest accomplishments of human beings in the Greeks' minds were inspired to do these works by way of these muses, you see? They're my muse. She's my muse. You hear that kind of description. Well, that's where it comes from. Now, the marvel, of course, is that all of these nine goddesses, these muses, sang their inspiration. They don't speak it. They don't whisper it. They sing it to the writers and so on. Now, as a musician, I would say that's enough right there. Let's just stop right there. They're terrific. They're musical, right? That's where we get the word music. So that which is inspired by the muses is music. Does that make sense? That's where it comes from. Now, here's the irony. Well, you get the idea that the Greeks thought of the inspiration of the muses as the highest accomplishments, the things that you really, really, really respect. The epics of Homer, the plays of Sophocles and Aristophanes and so on. All these great philosophers doing their work, and Terpsichore and her dance in the temples, and astronomy, the study of the stars, the inspiration of the understanding of the skies. All those things are inspired by the muses, and they sing their inspiration. So, you would think that music then would always be something really high up there. But what we do today in this idea that music is, and art in general, but especially music, is only for the purposes of entertaining me personally, since we think of it that way, let me say this first. When you put the letter A before a word as a prefix, what does it do to the word? Anybody tell me, say it louder. What's that? Yeah, the opposite of it. It negates it, doesn't it, right? So a theist is somebody that believes in God, but an atheist is somebody who doesn't believe in God or believes there's no God, right? So it's the opposite. Tonality is one thing, but atonality is the lack of tonality, right? So what does the word amuse mean? If to be mused means to be inspired by the muses, then to be amused would be the opposite of that, right? It would be either to not be inspired, or more likely, a momentary respite from being inspired. Do you see what I mean? We go to an amusement park. But we don't want to live there. We don't want to do our work there. We want a momentary respite from our hard work, don't we? We want to go and ride the roller coaster and eat cotton candy and have a good time, or whatever you do, at an amusement park. But that's the word, amusement. There's nothing wrong with being amused, but it's not the same thing as being mused, right? If that's still a word that we use. Well, here's the irony I was going to get to, now that you see that. Today, we use music to amuse ourselves. Something's deeply wrong about that. We've lost our way. We're blind to what music is really for. Okay, so how do we regain something of that? How do we regain it? I think it's by way of this understanding of beauty. If beauty is the connection, the sort of connecting point between the material world and the thing that you can't see, just like the Romeo and Juliet metaphor is, I understand what the sun is, but now I hear him say, Juliet is the sun. Ah, now I get something new. I didn't know that before, right? I can get a vision for that. When Jesus says, I'm the vine and you are the branches, I've known vines and branches, but now I get something deeper. I see something I didn't see before. I open my eyes to something that I hadn't seen before. That's the point of a metaphor. So it goes from what you know to what you don't know. But it does so by material shaped in a certain way in order to reflect or draw your attention to that thing that you didn't see before. This is why artists can be confused with prophets. In the 19th century, the kind of romantic view of an artist is somebody who is a kind of a prophet. He sees things nobody else sees, you see? A really great artist is somebody who paints or composes or writes something and that opens everybody's eyes to things that they hadn't seen before. Again, this is why I think that today we're so deadened, because we no longer think that art is for the purposes of seeing things we've never seen before. And so we don't give it the kind of attention, I guess, that it deserves. Well, I wanted to say something about stories and why I love stories. Parables open our eyes to things. Stories do that. I love them. But have you ever noticed that stories have a particular order to them? You have really three parts to a story. You always do. This goes for short stories, for novels, for films, for epic poems, for anything you can think of that's a storyline like that. There's a three-part work there. And if any of those three parts is missing, it's a very unsatisfying story. Those three parts are these: a kind of exposition where you get to know the people involved, and you probably get to know the problem that they're going through. And then you have a second section where that problem is exacerbated, gets worse, conflicts increase, until you get to the point of a kind of climax when something's got to be done about this problem. And then you have a third section that's the resolution of that conflict, one way or the other. In comedies, that resolution is usually a happy ending. It usually ends with a wedding. In a lot of Shakespeare plays, it always ends with a wedding. In tragedies, it's the other way around. Usually the lead character dies. The conflict is resolved, but it's resolved in a tragic way. Oedipus and his tragedy at the end. Macbeth and his tragedy at the end. And all the reasons why that happens. We don't need to talk about all that. But the form of it is what I'm after. Think about a story where you didn't introduce the characters or the problem to begin with. You just jump into a conflict and then resolve the conflict. Well, it's very hard to be inspired or to care for these people that are going through whatever this is. Or imagine introducing people and then going straight to the resolution. You say, once upon a time, they all lived happily ever after. You think, well, that's not much of a story either. Fairy tales, I forgot to put fairy tales in the list. They're really great. And worst of all is to introduce people, make you care about them, see the problem, see them working out the problem, getting up to the point of a climax and things have to be resolved, and then they stop and that's the end of the play. And you don't know how it ends. Well, that's terrible. So you need all three of them to be a story. Well, I want to argue that you can do the same thing with music, without words even. So I want to play you a piece of music. Maybe I should give you the form of it first. Hold on a second. This piece of music has three parts to it, strangely enough. It has an exposition where you hear a tune. And I'm going to put the tune in here as section one, for example. Maybe A is better. Let's say A, the A theme. And you hear the A theme twice. And then there is a B section, short B section, and then it's contrasted, and then the A theme comes back again at the end. This is all the exposition. Then you go into this middle section, this what you might call the development section, but it's really, in this case, that's too grand a title. It's just another tune. And the development section is a different key, it's a different concept, different things going on, and we'll hear it as we go by. And then at the end of this development section, there's a transition back to the A theme again, and you hear the A theme again. And we'll call this, say, the recap, short for recapitulation. These are terms that usually get used for a much larger theme, musical form called the sonata allegro form. But this is a very short form. I'm just going to use the same terms for ease of. So you have this A theme played twice, you have a little contrasting section here, and then you have the A theme played again, and then you have this new material. We'll call it C for the time being, because it's really kind of a theme all in, by itself. And it gets to a bit of a climax, and then we have this transition and we come back to A again, and it's in the original key, it sounds the same, and then you have a second time, and then you have what they call a coda. Some of you who were here last year know what a coda is. What's a coda? You remember? Yes, what is it? Tail. Good lad. Were you here last year? All right. I feel better already. Very good. Coda just means tail. It means an Italian word for tail. It's the ending of the thing, okay? So let's listen for it, and then listen to it, rather. It only takes a few minutes. And then we can talk about it. Crank it up just a hair. There we go. To this world of A, you get something else. Thank you. they're done. All but the little tail. Lovely. Just a simple little piece of music, right? So, you heard the A theme played twice with a little something here, and then the A theme again. Then you heard the development set, that contrasting section, and then they come back again. Now, my question to you is this. Is this A the same is this A? Did you notice any difference, or are they both the same? How many people say they're the same? Nobody? Anybody? How many say it's different? A lot of you say it's different. Very good. What was different about it? Can you tell me? Different time signature? A different pace, you say? Yeah, the time signature is the same, but I know what you're talking about. You're exactly right. There's something going on there that's different. Could you tell what it was? Yeah? No, it's the same key. The accompaniment. What's the accompaniment different? What's different about it? Do you remember? Repeated notes. Let me play you. Let's see if I can play you just those two bits. Here's the beginning. Can you hear how it's duplet? Two and three and four and one. That's what made you think it was a time signature change, but it really doesn't. It's just triplets. Let's see if I can get to the end and you can hear that. I didn't think about doing this. Okay, so here it is in the end. Hear the triplets, dot, dot, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. It's not duplets anymore. Ding, 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 ding. So that's different, isn't it? Why would he do it differently? Where did that come from? Where did that idea, that triplet idea, come from? Do you know? Because he anticipates that change in the A in that C section. If you remember, when you get here, the tune is da di di da da di, right? But underneath it is da bum bum di bum bum da bum bum da bum bum ba dum 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 two dum bum 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 triplets, right? So this is all duple. This contrasting bit has triplets in it, but when we come back to the A section again, something has changed. Something's different about this A, and it's different because we've gone through this. Is that amazing? It even happens before that. Let's see if I can do this. When he does the end of the A, it's something like, I'm going to botch this up because I can't remember how to play it all. It's like this. Oh, for heaven's sake, how does it go? I should have brought the sheet music so I could remember how to do it. But anyway, the figure that takes you from this A here to this A here is triplets. It's just a little arpeggio that it goes, we're back to A flat major, we're here, and he goes, before he goes to that second statement of the A, there's a little hint of a triplet. That triplet then becomes the accompaniment for this section here, and that becomes a genuine change in how the A is played when it comes back. So, what we've got here is home, away, and back home again. Only, home is not the same when we come back to it. That's the order of this thing. It's like a story. How many stories do you know that have that kind of order to it? The Hobbit, he's at home, he goes away, and he comes back home again, doesn't he? In The Lord of the Rings, it's the same way, isn't it? Frodo is at home, he has to go away to deal with the ring. When he comes back home again, is home the same as when he left it? Only you people who have read the books will know, because it's not in the movie. It's a whole chapter called The Scouring of the Shire. Do you remember? Some of you guys have read it. When he gets back there, there's all sorts of stuff to clean up. Things are not right there. Think of Odysseus. He goes off to the Trojan Wars. That's the Iliad. When he starts coming back again, he wants to go home, right? His whole motivation is to get home. Well, when he finally gets home, is all peace and quiet? No. Do you remember what's going on there? The suitors. Penelope, his wife, has been elbowing out suitors all this time, waiting for him in these 10 years to get home. Well, what I'm trying to say is that's part of this master story. It's a story where you start at home, but you might have a little bee in there, a bee in your bonnet, that causes conflict, causes trouble. That conflict works its way out in the middle part of the story, but then the conflict is resolved, and when you get resolution, it's not exactly the same. It's different. Many years ago, I was teaching this idea about 20 years ago probably in a class, college class, and before the class started, as I was kind of talking to them about what I was going to talk about, a couple of the kids were talking about how they had seen this new movie called Twister. You may have seen Twister. It's an old movie now, of course, but at the time it was in the theaters. And I said, I'll bet you I can tell you what the plot is of Twister. And they said, oh, come on, you haven't seen it. I said, I know I haven't seen it, but I can tell you what it is. What is it? I can tell you that there is a Twister, and that there's somebody who is involved with Twisters, and he probably has a relationship with somebody else, and that relationship is on the fritz. And because he goes through the conflict of dealing with this Twister, he gets back with her and life goes on better than it was before. And they had their jaws on the floor. And I said, what other plot can there be? That's the only plot you can have, see? I'm trying to tell you, there's really only one story that's ever told. It's the same story over and over and over and over again. It's told in the Odyssey, it's told in the Hobbit, it's told in the Odyssey, it's told in Cinderella. You start at home, but she is in bad shape, she's in a bad situation, and she eventually goes through this amazing transformation and eventually marries the prince, right? Well, that's a real close story to the gospel, it seems to me. Because what's the prince anyway, except the son of the king, right, who comes and because of his love sweeps her out of her, no pun intended, sweeps her out of her. Thank you for that. I appreciate that. Anyway, all those fairy tales were basically gospel stories in many ways, different aspects of the gospel story, because you've got, you know, Snow White, who falls asleep because she's bitten into an apple, a poisoned apple, and nobody can raise her from the dead, as it were. She's on her own. Who should come along but the prince, who's the son of the king from across the sea, and he kisses her, representing the love he has for her, and she awakens, and she marries him, and they live happily ever after, which is the gospel story, isn't it? You see? It's really only one story. We're constantly telling this story over and over and over again. We start with Luke Skywalker on his planet, you know, and he goes off and has his adventures, comes back again to a new world. He's now up. He's a better man. He's better off than he was when he started. You have the same thing with Macbeth. Only Macbeth starts off as a good man, and he ends up killed. He ends up dying, right? For the chutzpah he has of killing Duncan and all his desire for running the world. He can't escape the fates. He can't escape the magical premonitions of the witches. But that's the story, one way or the other. We're in the garden. In the garden, there is a serpent. The fall occurs, and the redemption, the work of redemption, starts right then, but it takes a long time to do. And eventually, we come home again. We were in the garden, and now we go back to the garden, right? No. No. It's what they might call the garden city. It's a new thing, isn't it? There's a new heavens and a new earth. It's not the same garden as it was. It's an A prime. it's the old tune with a new spin, a new accompaniment, a new goodness to it. That's the story we're telling. That's the story. And that's the story that music tells. That's the story that fairy tales tell. It's the story that epic poems tell. Every play you've ever seen, every movie you've ever seen, if it's satisfying, if it has all the elements, then it tells that story. Isn't that amazing? Could it be for all human beings across the whole universe and the history of the world, there's really only one story to tell? Isn't that amazing? Well, I think that's what's going on. And the beauty that we experience is the recognition, even if it's unconscious, it's a recognition of the relationship between the form of this thing that they created, the play or the piece of music or the whatever, and the story. It resonates with this reality, you see? And I think when we experience beauty, we're probably doing just that. Recognizing that thing. It's 7:30 and I have to quit in 15 minutes, and I have a couple of other examples. Would you like to hear one more piece before we quit? Ask questions? It would just be another example. Shall I play one more?
Yeah.
All right, I'll play one more. Here is a story in music. This is a another Beethoven piece. That was Beethoven's Pathetique Sonata, the middle movement, the second movement. This is the middle movement of a piano concerto he wrote, my favorite concerto. It's the number 4 concerto in G major. He wrote 5 of them. Oops, stop. Thank you. You don't have to do that. Okay. This is a short little piece for just the strings and the piano. Orchestra. But the piano very quietly says, raising the piano's voice, but the orchestra's still angry and aggressive. ever got angry and listened to the result in the orchestra. To two notes. And now just one note, pizzicato. And the piano is alone. And the orchestra has three notes. Gets the last word. Isn't that marvelous? There you have a story. No words, but can you relate to it? Can you imagine, use your imagination? Can you use that thing that unpacks parables to make sense of it? An aggressive, loud, angry orchestra and a quiet, peaceful piano. And they have a dialogue. And eventually the quiet, peaceful piano wins out and calms the beast, calms the anger, calms the... A lot of people think this is a man and a woman. You can understand it? The guy being aggressive and the woman calming him down. But you could say the other way around. Sometimes that happens. All the guys are saying, yeah, it happens the other way too. But isn't that amazing that you should be able to sort of distill that human interaction into a kind of metaphor, a kind of metaphoric treatment, a way of saying it that encapsulates it all and makes it clear. The kind word turns away wrath, for example. Isn't that interesting? Well, I don't know that he was thinking of that. I'm not trying to say Beethoven was thinking of that, or even thinking of men and women fighting. I don't know what he was thinking about. This is my interpretation of it. But it's clearly the elements of that, do you see? It's like the bare bones of something, the distillation of a human experience into a work of art. That's the greatness of these things. I may be able to play one more real fast if Jared will let me. There's a movement, we've been talking, a couple of us, during the day about the Brahms Requiem, and it's a piece I've always loved. And I thought, well, maybe there would be a good example from it. The fifth movement of the Brahms Requiem is a statement by Jesus. The text is a statement by Jesus that is from John 16:22, and it says, "Now ye therefore have sorrow, but I will see you again, and your heart will rejoice, and your joy no man can take from you." That's John 16. And later on in it, he quotes, he jumps to Isaiah 66 and writes, "I will comfort you as a mother comforts her child." That's Isaiah 66. It's in German, of course, but that's the translation of those two bits of it. Now, what's funny about this piece is that it's written for a soloist. You would expect Jesus' words, God's words, to come in a soloist. But it's in the soloist chosen for this, what Brahms chose, was a soprano. He writes it for a woman to sing. It's very interesting. Would you mind playing it for us? Can you show us that? This one is actually video. You can see this. It's very short, but I want you to hear it. BACH anxiety, is it? Here you will have Traurigkeit. But then she says, Aber, but. Is that in German, "I will see you again" is Wiedersehen. And when you say goodbye to somebody in German, you say Auf Wiedersehen. I will see you again. You see, that's what that means. Auf Wiedersehen. Well, she's singing Wiedersehen, Wiedersehen. And it's his mother saying goodbye to him. You see? So he's using this moment of Jesus' comfort for us and making it have a double meaning. And the most astonishing thing about it is at the very end, she says, Wiedersehen, 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 and she fades off. She gets softer and softer and softer. And the very, very last time she says Zehen, the clarinet player comes in very softly underneath her, and she fades out, and the clarinet fades in, and she's gone. So it's the moment of her death, her departure. Listen to the very end of it. I'll play it and then we'll have to quit. Sleight of hand. Thank you. That's perfect. That's all we need. So it can tell all sorts of kinds of stories. Music can. Maybe I should just leave it there. Thank you very much for having me this weekend. I've really enjoyed being with you, and I hope that you will stick around and chat with me if you'd like to. I think I better quit rather than answer questions, because I'm going to take us over time. But I think your break is until 8 o'clock, is that right? Okay, so it's, what, 13 minutes you have for a break, and then Jared is going to come join us. Thanks again, everybody. I'm glad to be here.